was 18 to 1,802,000. Yeah. And my paper was 10 pages, 3,800.
Feminist Lunch Series. I'm delighted. Yes. Thank you all for coming out. I'm Sasha Mullally from the Department of History, and along with Sylvia Law, I chair the Feminist Lunch Series. This is our second year running, and we are delighted, as I mentioned, to kick off 2018 with such a large crowd and such a lot of enthusiasm for Dr. Erin Morton's presentation today of What Does Whiteness Do? Son of Colonialism, Feminism, and Epistemic Innocence. Before she begins, though, there are a couple of entities that I want to thank to support this series. I'd like to thank the Gender and Women's Studies Program for being the main support and organizing entity behind all the work that we hear over the course of the actual year and the processes of this lunch brown bag event. I'd also like to thank the Office of the Dean of Arts that supports it as well, and also the UNB St. Thomas University Women's Center, who offer a lot of in-kind and media support. They do a lot of disseminating when it comes to bringing out crowds to listen to these important talks. So thank you goes to them. And for those of you who don't know Dr. Erin Morton, I would like to highlight a couple things about her. She's in the Department of History, as I mentioned, but she's a visual culture specialist. And she has a recent book out. If you're interested, you should pick up a copy of For Folk's Sake, Art and Economy in 20th Century Nova Scotia. It's a great read. I finished it not too long ago, and I highly recommend it. And she's just started a new project that sounds fascinating to me. Maybe you'll have a chance to ask her about it. It's called Unsettling the Settler Artist, Reframing the Canadian Visual Arts, 1867 to the Present. Without any further introduction, I'll hand things over to Erin.
Thank you, Sasha, and thanks to you all for coming. This is a great turnout. I'm delighted to see this. I prepared the paper expecting kind of more of a seminar-style working lunch. I'm going to go with the original plan, despite the interest, which I'm really pleased to see. So I want to begin this talk by acknowledging that we are on the unceded land of the Wolastoqe people, who have taken care of this place along the Wolastoqe River for thousands of years. This land is bound by the Peace and Friendship Treaties of 1725 to 1779, signed at various stages between the British and the Wabanaki Confederacy. While it is important for me to begin this talk on settler colonialism and white appropriation with a territorial acknowledgement, Indigenous feminist scholars from Métis writer Chelsea Bowell to Dakota scholar Dr. Kim Tallbear have of course questioned what such statements of territory mean in institutional and academic settings, such as this, when white settlers like me say them. As Bowell writes, and I'm quoting her, in what spaces do these acknowledgments happen? And more importantly, where are they not found? What can exist beyond territorial acknowledgments? I think we need to start imagining a constellation of relationships that must be entered into beyond territorial acknowledgments, end quote. In Tallbear's case, she writes, I live and work in pursuit of new ways of loving, lusting, and losing amidst the ruins and survivals together of my ancestors' ways of relating. Some of these ethical orientations include a sense of being in good relation that is measured by actual relating rather than by doctrine, end quote. So I want to begin this talk not only with this acknowledgement of territory and treaty, but also with the ethical orientations that Bowell and Tallbear provide us with here. They are asking what it means to be and live in good relation with one another on this side of the medicine line, in Canada, on Turtle Island, in Wabanaki, the Wabanaki homeland of the Abenaki, Mi'kmaq, Passamaquoddy, Penobscot, and Wolastoqe. Further, what does it mean to be and live in good relation with one another in a place where, to use Sylvia Hamilton's term, formerly enslaved black freedom runners ran north to bondage, to draw on the title of Dr. Harvey and Monty Whitfield's recent book. There. That's the territorial acknowledgement slide. And there we go. This is a place of many ancestries, of multiple colonial violences, with many forms of kinship, interrelation, and of forced migration, bondage, and theft of land, liberty, and language. We often hear the phrase, we are all treaty people. But I want to suggest here today that such utterances don't say anything about responsible and ethical relations when it comes to white settlers interacting with indigenous and black geographies here, not to mention interacting with the histories of variously racialized migrations and arrivals that include generations of people of color of all faiths. So what I'm really asking is, what does it mean to share this place ethically, given the colonial histories that continue to shape it? So now that I've set up my positioning of the place, I want to return to the highly ambitious abstract that I've proposed for us today. And even though I don't think I'll be able to do justice to all of the ideas in that abstract, as per usual, this is typical with a talker conference paper, I want to say, first of all, that it was ambitious for a reason. I think that we're at a critical time in the Academy. We are approaching a long overdue moment on this side of the medicine line regarding the entrance of Indigenous and Black scholars into the Academy of all levels. Of course, on the one hand, there have been Indigenous, Black, and people of color faculty and students for decades. But at the same time, we are now in a moment of truth and reconciliation, a moment in which words like decolonization, indigenizing, and even Black feminist legal scholar Kimberly Crenshaw's term, intersectionality, get deployed in casual and metaphorical ways to describe the university trying to do good work. This rhetoric is familiar, of course, and has in many ways only shifted former, more liberal philosophical language about tolerance, inclusivity, multiculturalism, and immigration, which actually pose and deal with much different questions of who gets to belong in the university, and by extension in the national body politic, as feminist critical race scholars from Sarah Ahmed to Shireen Razak to Hemani Banerjee have critiqued for decades now. All of these words, of course, get taken up by white settler students, scholars, and administrators, by white people, in the name of improvement, progress, and the remaking of our institutions, our communities, and our imaginations for the better. The interventionist work of Eve Tuck and Kay Wang Yang have crucially stated that decolonization is not a metaphor. But many, many Black, Indigenous, and people of color scholars have likewise shown that neither is intersectionality or indigenization. As Tuck and Yang put it, decolonization brings about the repatriation of Indigenous land and life. It is not a metaphor for other things we want to do to improve our societies and schools. Métis scholar Zoe Todd complicates this issue when she writes, "The reason I no longer say we need to indigenize academy is because in this post-truth and reconciliation era, institutions and powerful settler elites are very much prone to using indigenous issues to cover and obscure ongoing anti-blackness in Canada." And while we often hear the phrase, feminism without intersectionality is white supremacy, Crenshaw coined the term to specifically describe violence against Black women, to see power where it interlocks, collides, and intersects. She writes more than 20 years after coining this term, and I'm quoting her here, "Some people look at intersectionality as a grand theory of everything, but that's not my intention. The other issue is that intersectionality can get used as a blanket to mean, well, it's complicated. Sometimes it's complicated is an excuse not to do anything." So I want to pose some basic and yet still very crucial questions about these practices of white feminists like me wanting to do good work by learning from the words, the lives, and yes, even the deaths of Black, Indigenous people of color. And I want to say that I am posing hard questions because I remain in love with feminist dreaming and praxis, even when I seek to pull it apart. I remain convinced that we can build things together as much as we can take them down. But I think we need to ask white feminism some very tough questions right now, not only because Black, Indigenous people of color have been asking them for decades, but because living in good relation and undertaking ethical work requires these hard questions. I think the moment we are in is incredibly important to constantly question our own motivation. And here I'm talking about myself and my motivations and my own complicities for taking up Black and African diaspora studies, Indigenous studies, and critical race and ethnic studies in r/my classroom and in r/my scholarship. And here I'm using the we language, the language I tell my students not to do, so here I'm rule breaking. But I'm doing this to highlight that I'm really talking about my own individual complicity in the structural violences I'm critiquing here and in my research and teaching, and I'm talking specifically about settler colonialism, anti-blackness, and Islamic racism. And also the structural and actual complicity that white settlers share across these valences. So in other words, I'm seeking here a self-critique in ways that I also hope don't reaffirm my own positioning and recentering of whiteness in ways that I know are also violent. I'm usually against the practice of the so-called white confessional of taking up space in conversation where I shouldn't be anyway to say where I've gone wrong and how I've learned to be better. But I think I need to confess a few things, probably, because I'm in search of new ways to have these conversations ethically without recentering whiteness myself. I'm not quite at a solution place yet. So all this to say, I'm aware that my deliberations here are entirely imperfect. But the question I want us all to consider, following the work of Talbert, is what does it mean for white feminists to be and live in good relations with the black, indigenous, and people of color feminists whose work often gets erased and silenced in feminist scholarship, even if intersectionality, decolonization, and indigeneity are frameworks that operate very much in vogue in academic and activist spaces right now. So I want all of us, but I'm especially speaking to my fellow white feminists here, to think about how our good intentions can be violent. And I say this knowing that whiteness is not a monolith, that cis heteronormativity and ability also pervades whiteness and its relational privileges, that cis hetero able-bodied folks like me operate with a tremendous amount of structural and actual privilege despite our experience of gender discrimination. So I want us to think about all of these very big questions together. So that's my preamble. I'm gonna get into some content now. And I'm gonna start with this question, what does whiteness do? And I ask this because I think it is a way to consider critically the ways in which whiteness turns feminist conversations, pedagogies, and research in particular ways. A subtitle to this talk might have even been, Everything I Know, I Have Learned from Queer, Trans, Black, Indigenous People of Color. But then I have to ask myself, what does my whiteness do to these lessons? Where does it turn the conversation? How does my embodied presence as a white settler feminist scholar, on a panel, in a classroom, or in a research collaboration, turn things to reorient thoughts and feelings towards whiteness through Rahm-Sarah-Ahmed's work? This orientation, which Ahmed of course positions in terms of queer people of color feminism, is useful to me here. But again, this is where I have to begin my self-critique. Ahmed is talking about the orient in sexual orientation and orientalism, and questioning what it means to turn bodies in certain directions, in particular spaces and times. Orientations matter, she writes. To be orientated shapes the surface of the writer's body. Orientations make form. Orientations have material and embodied consequences. And so this is a good example to explore what I mean in the abstract by epistemic innocence. This idea that I can take on Ahmed's concept of orientation for my own purposes and extract from it what is useful to me. Does it belong to me? No, but it's useful, isn't it? And this is a process that Dr. Eve Tuck has named reading extractively for discovery. And I would like to suggest here today that such fluidity of concepts leads to white settler uses of knowledge that has been stolen through colonial processes, retrieved through survival practices of Black, Indigenous people of color scholarship, and then once again reappropriated by white settler scholars. To quote Tuck, to watch white settlers sift through our work as they ask, isn't there more here for me? Isn't there more for me to get out of this? And then she continues, I have spent most of my career in education trying to convince non-Indigenous people to read Indigenous people. Now that there's been a turn to where we already are, unsurprisingly surprised by how demonstratively settlerish their reading is. Isn't there something less theoretical, something more theoretical, something more practical, something less radical, more possible? Can't you just make something that imagines it clearly enough for me to see it, for me to just plunk it into my own imagination? Can't you do more work for me? Because I've given this a whole 5 minutes of thought and I don't see the future like you. I have spent this entire time being complicit in your deaths and feeling like I earned the right to ask you to do more work. I'll just keep sifting through all of this work that was never meant for me anyway. sorting it by what is useful to me and what is discardable. I'll complain, saying it's too theoretical, and stay oblivious to the way that this theory, to me, is life for Indigenous people. Tuck concludes, I forgot all these years of relation between settler and Indigenous peoples set up settlers to be terrible readers of Indigenous work. If you suspect this thread is about you, it probably is. This reading for extraction and discovery is what I have come to call epistemic innocence. This process of using the work of Black Indigenous people of color to understand my own orientations, my own position in scholarship, my own place in the world. And what I'm asking here is, what does a feminist praxis that relies on epistemic innocence to make its critiques really accomplish? What does it mean that my own bodily presence orients the feminist conversation or moment in the world towards whiteness? For example, specifically by using the work of Black Indigenous people of color extractively, by claiming to discover it in ways that mirror the colonial violences that halted or stole Black Indigenous people of color knowledge in the first place. If, for example, Indigenous knowledge has to be rebuilt in ways that imagine an Indigenous future that settlers probably will never understand, at least right now, what does it mean then to use it as a non-Indigenous person? What does whiteness do in these moments, and how are these engagements and these orientations themselves violent? In what ways do my complicities in these structures prevent me from being and living in good relation, or from forming ethical conversations through my scholarship? And once again, where does whiteness turn the conversation? So I'm now going to give you two examples of the ways in which I'm trying to pursue these very big conceptual questions. One is from a paper that I'm working on, and the other is from teaching, and some of my students who are in this class are here, so you're going to get to hear me think out loud about some of the stuff we covered. But I want to position both of these examples as examples of my own good intentions, which nevertheless reorient the conversation in structurally violent ways. My good intentions are violent complicities. If I was lecturing to an undergrad class, I'd tell you to write that down, because that's what I usually do. So I'll just say it again for emphasis. My good intentions are violent complicities. The complicities I speak of here are the everyday complicities in anti-blackness, settler colonialism, and Islamo racism. But here is the kicker, and this is what I really want us to think about. These complicities in these violent structures remain, even in moments when we seek to dismantle them. Despite my good intentions and despite my desire to live in good and responsible relation. My good intentions might look like this. I condemn the white supremacist posters and anti-Semitic, anti-immigration remarks that they make that have gone up around campus lately. I condemn writers like Jordan Peterson. But what does this condemnation mean? It means that I want to orient myself away from the real racists, the real bigots, the bad white people, because I am not them. My orientation is distance, because my intentions are good. Now, I think many of us in the room are familiar with the usual tactics of confronting something like the posters that we've been so concerned about lately. And this is the tactic of public condemnation. This tactic can be a useful one, but it can also be one that produces more of the lateral violence that I'm speaking about. For one thing, engaging in condemning these types of statements can redirect violence to people more vulnerable than me. So for example, commenting in the media or making public declarations about racism can signal anti-racist solidarity and support. But it can also point more extreme violence towards more vulnerable people. So what I'm really saying is condemning racism as a white person, first of all, is not really that hard. It doesn't bear the physical, mental, and emotional risks for white people that it does for Black, Indigenous people of color. And moreover, the condemnation doesn't do anything to dismantle the violence that is being condemned. In some cases, it might even make it worse, even if it can also, at the same time, function as a gesture of solidarity. So I'll get back to that in a minute. But for now, I want to ask, who do the anti-racist condemnations of white people really serve? And here's where I'll use an example from a paper I'm working on. And this is a paper that has honestly sent me in circles. It has caused me, rightfully so, many ethical dilemmas about my good intentions. about the ways in which, despite my self-critiques deep down, I still want to reorient myself as a good white person who does good things. So the good things I'm talking about, they're things like opposing settler colonialism, despite the fact that I own land here, opposing anti-blackness, despite the fact that it structures my intentions through a white savior complex, and as someone who espouses anti-racism, despite the fact that I'm never on the front lines of this groundwork, because I can also afford to take a step back. What I'm suggesting here is that well-intentioned so-called anti-racist condemnations of events like the UNB posters might also help me distance myself from my own complicities in violence. I'm trying ultimately to distinguish myself from that racist white person over there who isn't me. It makes me feel good not to be that person, to be the better white person in the room, if you will. So the example from the recent paper is really a question of who gets to tell stories about settler colonial pasts and futures, and how white settler scholars discuss histories and use images of black and indigenous death and suffering to critique settler colonialism and anti-blackness. This is because these reproductions of black and indigenous death and suffering solidify the notion that black and indigenous death equals social death and elimination and erasure from land. So in what ways do white settler reproductions of indigenous and black death and suffering in our scholarship confirm what white settlers already think at a structural level? That indigenous people need to be eliminated and erased according to the logic and structure of settler colonialism, and that black people die because they are less than human, according to the logic of anti-blackness that has its roots in transatlantic slavery. These are big conceptual questions, and I'm not claiming to have the answers, for the record. The paper in question, though, that I wrote, regards the case of white rural landowner Gerard Stanley's murder of a young Cree man named Okumbushi in August of 2016. The event was a crucial reminder to those of us who have the luxury of forgetting that anti-Indigenous violence in the same place where Louis Riel and eight Cree and Assiniboine warriors were hanged in 1885 has continued. Stanley's crime became all the more notorious because it was defended by groups of white farmers online and at the courthouse as just, because Stanley had the right to defend his land as property and his implements of farm labor from the threat that merely the presence of a Cree person could elicit. So I wrote the paper to consider the fact that Stanley's wife Lisa was widely reported as yelling, "This is what you get for trespassing on private property," after her husband pulled the trigger and killed Bushi. Moreover, the RCMB treatment of Bushi's mother, Debbie Baptiste, in the wake of his murder was about as horrific as you might imagine. The criminalization of indigenous men like Bushi on the plains, whose mere presence on white farmland suggested a threat, was only mirrored by the criminalization of indigenous motherhood. In this case, the RCMP surrounded Baptiste's home the night of the murder, broke down the door, smelled her breath, and asked her if she was drunk. The RCMP later cleared itself of any wrongdoing through its own investigatory process, and I'll come back to that point later. But the end of the story with me writing the paper is that I presented three iterations of this work recently. The first was at a symposium here at UNB about a year ago, then later at a closed workshop at the University of Alberta, and then at an academic conference in November at the National Women's Studies Association in Baltimore. And this is where I want to question my good intentions, the ones that form the feminist praxis that I also want to use to critique the death regime that is settler colonialism. I presented these papers using territorial acknowledgments that consider the legacies of indigenous elimination and erasure, and of transatlantic slavery in the same way that I did today. In Edmonton, I talked about Treaty 6 and the connections between the number treaty system, the events of 1885, the influx of enslaved people of African descent, and racialized indentured laborers in the prairies who built the white homestead, and the violence of the pioneer image as the founding mythology of what I call the white proletariat farmer. In Baltimore, for the National Women's Studies Association conference, I talked about the backdrop of the Camino sugar factory in the harbor against the tall ship replica that suggested the arrival of early settlers in the Chesapeake Bay, the waterway in which the first enslaved Africans came to the Jamestown colony. and the papers all went very well. And I'm not saying this for self-promotion. I'm saying this because I want to use this positive scholarly response to my work to pull apart my good intentions and the accolades they very easily bring me as a white settler scholar. I think that this pulling apart is absolutely crucial in the work of rebuilding responsible and ethical relations. In all three of these papers, I received high praise from senior Indigenous feminist scholars, who I respect pretty much more than any other writer on the planet. And I tried to receive it generously, with the gratitude that I think it was intended with. But when I really thought about it, I had to remember that the bar for me is so very low. The expectations of what white feminists will say is so low. My words and praxis are well-intentioned. It's okay to laugh. But my presentations also had crucial ethical errors that took me really thinking about, then rethinking, and then rereading to fully understand. When I said that in one of these three presentations, I was worried about discussing Gerald Stanley's shooting of Colton Bushi through the lens of white property and imperial turned settler colonial violence against Plains Indigenous peoples, and that this in fact would reorient the papers and the crime towards whiteness. One of the Indigenous panels said, "Aaron, how do you identify?" And I said, "As a white settler." And she said, "I think white people should study other ways." So in that moment, I took this simple statement as a generous validation of my work. And this is precisely where I want to suggest the danger and violence of my good intentions. It was exciting for me to get this response from a scholar who I respect deeply, who I had read for years, and who I had just met and engaged with at an academic setting. And I know those of you who are academics here, you know what that's like, and we've experienced this in different ways. It is exciting to get praise from your sheroes. But the stakes of living in good relations and ethical responsibility with Indigenous feminist knowledge requires me to do more than take a scholarly compliment as one that helps me mark my work as good, as one that suggests that I am thinking about settler colonialism in the right way, that I am dismantling white supremacy in the right way, that I don't have to think too hard about my own complicities because I'm already doing the right things. This is where my good intentions become structurally violent in reproducing the very same structures of violence I seek to dismantle. My whiteness operates in a particular way when I tell the story of Gerald Stanley and Colton Bushi. I get to discuss the violence, but I don't have to live with it beyond that. Living and dying with anti-Indigenous violence is not my embodied experience in the world. The violence is not in my bones in the way that it is for Debbie Baptiste, Colton's mother, who held a feast to celebrate her son's life and invited the RCMP to the table. She invited the RCMP to the table. And you know, when I first read that in the news, I couldn't believe it. And I couldn't believe it because I have no idea what it means to live in that space of generosity as a space of survival, what it requires to be generous for survival. So I don't get to take the generosity of Indigenous feminists lightly. I need to see it in the matrix of decolonizing relations that it truly deserves, and that Indigenous feminists are at the forefront of. My good intentions don't get to take up space in the midst of these important reimaginings of good relations. So let me now turn to the teaching example to tell you more about what I mean by this. The teaching example is also a difficult one in terms of figuring out my complicities in relation to my good intentions. And again, I'm not at the solution part yet. This is an example about who gets to teach stream of knowledge that are nourishment to Black Indigenous people of color. So while I have a PhD that included a comprehensive field in critical race and ethnic studies and feminism, I still don't feel that I have the ethical or intellectual authority to teach many of the texts that fall into these fields. And that continued discomfort is important for me to feel. And my students are here. So they will know that despite the ethical dilemmas I'm going to talk about, I did many of the things I'm about to critique anyway. The example I will use is from my graduate syllabus and concerns the work of the Jamaican feminist philosopher and writer Sylvia Winter, whose work has recently seen a reemergence thanks to Catherine McKidrick's 2014 edited volume on the praxis of being human. The volume includes new and old work by Winter, as well as several essays on its significance for African diaspora and Black studies. Now, Winter's work, if you haven't read it, it's famous for many things. It's famous for its theoretical complexity, for her feminist interventions into the work of anti-colonial Caribbean writers like Frantz Fanon and Amy Césaire. It's famous for her dismantling of the project of European enlightenment. But arguably her most famous assertion is that 1492 created not only a new world order, but that it also created a new manner in which to engage the category of the human itself as praxis. Her arguments center around the ways in which colonial encounters and slavery have crystallized race in ways that make us all question who and what we are as human, and that establish new ways of being together that impact the world as we know it up to the present. At the end of her famous 1995 essay entitled 1492, A New World View, Winter takes these deliberations to the figure of Columbus himself. Columbus, whose violent voyages across the Atlantic created the routes and the routes for settler colonialism and transatlantic slavery, who provided the impetus for a new world order that Lisa Lowe has famously described as the intimacies of four continents. Winter ascribes to Columbus a humanity and writes that in order for us to understand ourselves, we need to understand the humanity of someone who enacted such violence. After meticulously dissecting the European Enlightenment rationality and scientific progress that created the category of the human through notions about biological racial hierarchies, Winter then humanizes Columbus, the person the most responsible for enacting these negotiations of humanity violently on the ground. Winter, a Black Caribbean feminist writer, humanizes Columbus. The reason this is a teaching example, this is a difficult teaching example, is of course because from my subject position as a white scholar, I use this text with tremendous hesitation, and I question whether or not I should be using it at all. The first time I read 1492, I was swept up with what Winter proposes. I was swept up in her vision. She, in a different way than Talbert, is asking what it means to live in good relation with those who have created the violence that marks the bodies of the colonized, the enslaved. These are not exactly the same questions, of course, and the implications for Black geographies of survival necessarily look different than Indigenous geographies of survival. But I'm bringing these two writers into conversation with one another because the premises of epistemic innocence and the seduction that they offer are very similar. What are the ethical implications of non-Black scholars using Winter's writing? What if these non-Black writers imagine a world that allows white settlers to carve out what Tuck and Yang following Shireen Razdick call a road to innocence? So what does it mean for me, a white scholar, to take up Winter's project in my classroom? To teach it in a complex classroom with students who have various ranges of experience with colonialism and the legacies of slavery. On the one hand, I tell myself, I want Black students to know this work if they don't already. And then I need to ask myself, what is my good intention here? And what does my good intention do to reorient Winter to whiteness? This is what is most commonly known as a white savior complex, but I think it can more productively be framed in the way that Muslim feminist scholar Shays de Patel does, as a lateral violence that is, at best, a giving back of that which has been epistemologically stolen. It is, once again, a white settler reappropriation of Black knowledge that has been stolen and that has had to be rebuilt. But on the other hand, I ask myself, what does it also mean to put Winter's words not only on the tongues of white feminists who, like me, at best, read it for extraction and discovery, who recolonize her intentions, but also on the tongues of those who reject it entirely? There aren't easy answers here, of course, and I recently attended a panel on the work of the African-American writer Hortense Spillers, whose theoretical complexity in many ways parallels Winter, and one of the panelists asked a crucial question when it comes to reading these types of complex theoretical works. Who are you willing to sit with, and why? If Blackness in the Americas is born of violence, as Tiffany King writes, then what exactly are non-Black people sitting with when they read Winter? Conclusion. As the Cree author Billy Ray Belcour writes, the body remembers when the world broke open. We are not done mourning the world-shattering magnitude of settler invasion and its attendant crimes of all sorts, and that this kind of loss yields affects that reverberate into the near future by way of the body's critical receptivity. That is, the ease with which we can be undone and displaced by others in supposedly reconciliatory times like ours. Indigenous artists are burdened with answering the call to envision a good post-colonial future, but we are still hurting in the present, and we are not finished trying to figure out how to activate collective survival. I wanted to begin my concluding remarks with Belfour's words, to remember what is at stake in the multiple and overlapping structures of colonial violence, of epistemic innocence, and of the structural complicity that I've been talking about today. And what is at stake for striving to live in good relation with one another and in ethical responsibility with this place? What I hope that my talk today suggests is that the stakes for white folks are different than they are for Black, Indigenous people of color. That no amount of my reading of scholarly, creative, and activist writing from these scholars will ever cue my body to experience the world in the way that Belfour, for instance, writes about. The stakes for ethical relations are different, and what this means is that no amount of reading for extraction and discovery in a gesture of epistemic innocence, no amount of good intentions to be a better white person than that racist white person over there who I may seek distance from, will de-escalate the elements of alt-right, white supremacist thinking that many of us at UNB are so concerned with right now. And here I have to take responsibility, too, for the fact that the posters for this talk, my talk, and the language that I use in the abstract may have actually elicited this postering campaign in the first place. And while I think it is extremely important to talk and think about the issues I have surveyed today in public, I think we also need to get better at figuring out why we are speaking about these things and how we are speaking about them. My using the academic rhetoric that I am today is not very effective in dismantling the white supremacist views these posters are concerned with. It is intellectual, it is theoretical, it is academic. The dictum, if it's inaccessible to the poor, it's neither radical or revolutionary, comes to mind here. And this is not the perspective that leads most of my research, I will admit that. And it is certainly not the way in which I began thinking about what I was going to say today. I conceptualized this talk long before this post-rank campaign occurred on UNB campus. But I want to conclude with two thoughts. The first is that liberal, so-called woke or radical or anti-racist white people allies are part of the problem. The ally industrial complex is real, and so is the white settler academic career builder who researches, lectures, and publishes on the lives and deaths of Black, Indigenous people of color. Mohawk scholar Audre Simpson has said, "The settler will hate us until we are dead." And the settler will also research these lives until that death comes. And it's not a surprise that I didn't figure this out on my own. This is another thing that I have had to learn through the seemingly unending generosity of Black, Indigenous people of color writers and intellectuals who I've engaged with on these issues. So I'm going to end today with the words of African Nova Scotian poet and activist Elle Jones, who after a particularly violent and racist attack against her in the media, wrote an essay called, "I Just Threw Up a Little in My Mouth." "I threw up after I wrote this," she writes. "I know there are people out there who are enraged by me, people who very literally want to see harm come to me. And yet, I'm going to sit down anyway and write more things that people will want to hurt me for, and that they will need to paint me as a savage, or not human, or a monkey, or just some other ugly thing for." The stakes for me writing what I just presented to you today, they're not this high. I do not throw up in my mouth when I write these things, because despite some layers of gendered marginality, that are of course always important to acknowledge, my body does not have to engage with the legacies of colonial violence outside of my complicities in them. I can write about Gerald Stanley's crime, and I can acknowledge my structural complicity in it. While at the same time, I can also walk away from the everyday threats and violences that Indigenous people face at the hands of white settlers like me. If my body doesn't remember when the world broke open, perhaps it does remember something else. That is the roots of where these justifications of violence stem from that can help drive solutions together. The constant appeal of Winter's work is that her reimagining being human as praxis creates a space of possibility for us all to live together in responsible relation with one another. Whether or not this premise is mine to take up is ultimately the question. And I want to leave off today with one image from Métis Salto, a Polish artist, Dana Danger, which was featured in the spring cover issue of Canadian Art Magazine. And in that issue, Indigenous editor-at-large Lindsay Nixon wrote an essay about this piece called "This Work Is Not For You." As Nixon writes, Danger herself once said in response to a white curator who couldn't see himself in her work, "This work isn't for you." And if the work, the land, the text, isn't for you, isn't for me, what next? I think the stakes of being included in something like this are fraught, and I think that we need to talk about that. White folks like me need to think about these posters, for instance, and take a step back and try to grapple with how we ourselves may have led to their creation. If Debbie Baptiste can break bread with the RCMP, if Sylvia Winter can humanize Columbus, surely this is not too big a conceptual leap for us too. We need to abandon the white liberal epistemologies of colonial knowing, not because we need to jettison every facet of white European thought, history, or experience in the ways that white extremists might fear, but because we need to follow the path of decolonial unknowing with the understanding that white folks don't get to determine that path,